A very good evening to you and a warm welcome to our program Spotlight. And on Spotlight, we usually touch on current topics and also highlight and give you an insight on the measures taken. So today's topic would be on renewable energy, and to do the honors, we have two dignitaries in the studios with us. We have Mr. Ronald Comister, who is the Deputy General Manager of CEB. A very good evening to you and welcome.
Thank you. Thank you.
And we also have Deputy General Manager of CEB, Mr. Kamal Pereira, with us.
Yes.
A very good evening to you too. So today's topic would be on renewable energy on Spotlight. But before we get into that topic, give us an insight into the history of CEB and how it all started.
Okay, thank you very much for giving this chance. You know, CEB means Ceylon Electricity Board. It has come to that level, you know, by an act called the year 1969, by an act of CEB Act. After that, the name came as Ceylon Electricity Board. Earlier, this particular job had been done by another entity called Government Electrical Undertakings. Now, Renewable Energy and Electricity Board, CEB, is, I would like to put in a say like that, you know, it is two sides in the same coin. From the day number one, when you started trying to give the supply to the rest of the country, the British era, it was given by a diesel generator at the one particular hotel in Colombo. After that, the late Vimala Surendra had the vision to get the supply from the hydro. And from the day on that words, our country was completely fed by the hydroelectricity. So hydro means renewable. So there was a particular time the country was fully fed by the hydro. So 100% hydro. That means renewable. So renewable is not a different a distant star. It is a part and parcel of CEB. So when it comes like that, you know, electricity board has been developed and it be established under by name. And from 69 onwards, the country has been developing. At the very first time, the electrification and the country's electrification is a very low level. Mm-hmm. About 20% of the country's population at the electric level.
And where do we stand now?
Oh, it's almost 100%. You have to find the lines where to give it. There are no supply for the people who are yet to get supply. Others all have supply. So, and after the electrification of that one, the country's industrialization and the total hydro dependency, we experience the repercussions of the droughts. So we have the bad history of, you know, every 4 years like that, we get the, Sri Lanka get the drought. So when we dependent completely on the electricity, on the hydro, you know, when the drought comes, no electricity. So we had the regular power.
Scarcity problems.
Then, you know, the planners that decide, okay, while having the hydro, we must have to have the other non-renewable as well, going for thermal.
So it's like going for alternatives.
Alternate for the electric supply.
Right.
So renewable was at that time, you know, I must emphasize, at that time we talk only the renewable as only as the hydro. Hydro and hydro only. But nowadays, electric, some other renewable means some other details also there. So when I'm going to talk about the history of that one, now hydro was there, then we thought about getting the thermal part of it. When country's demand is increasing, our planners had been exploited all the possible hydro resources while encouraging to get the thermal as well. So early it was 100%, it has driven from 60, 80 to 20, 70 to 30 and 60 to 40 like that, you know, changes had been taken place in the mixture. So right now, if we put in the correct picture, we have a source of energy mix where the renewables and the thermal, where you get the total combination of the energy sources in order to give the supply for the country uninterrupted for 7/24/7. And it is not dependent on the seasonalities, it is not dependent on the mother God's reasons, then everything is looked after by that one. So if I put that one, our renewable story is something like that, but I must emphasize like this also. At the very first stage of renewable is only hydro. That hydro and the present day renewable is not only the hydro. We have the wind, we have the solar, we have the other miniature version of hydro, and everything is there. Now this hydro and the solar and the wind, we have a drastic difference, though the name renewable is there. It is the major hydros are steady. You can demand and control and, you know, dispense energy at a given command. But the soul and the wind is, it is not, you know, command and control based. We have to be acted according to their happenings. So it is, we call the variables, you know, variable renewable energy source. So because of that, present day renewables are completely the mixture of the renewables of steady state as well as the renewable part of it.
Right, that was a great insight as to how CEB started and also what CEB does. But let's also talk about the achievements of the Ceylon Electricity Board.
So, my colleague, Mr. Kamal, will do the needful.
If we look at the achievements of renewable energy sources in CEB, I would just say in the year 1996, Ceylon Electricity Board started purchasing renewable energy from private sector. So that was a cornerstone in the history. From that point onwards, CEB initiated purchasing renewable energy source generated electricity, mainly hydro. So through that one, now we can say we have mini hydro projects totaling to a capacity of 450 megawatts of renewable sources, mainly through mini hydro. Now, that story gradually, now initially it was mini hydro only, then the technologies of solar and wind both developed, say after 2010 like. So from that point onwards, more and more solar and mainly solar and wind started coming into the grid as small power producers in the range of less than 10 megawatt. Mm-hmm. Now, if you look at the present standard, present renewable energy mix in CEB, it's roughly around 250 megawatts of wind and close to 650 megawatts of solar are now connected and running. So that is roughly the mini hydro in the sense renewable part. I mean, it's apart from the major hydros that we have, which was the
start. Give me a second. That is the word we use. We call it major hydro. Uh-huh. That is also renewable, but it is major
yes.
hydro.
It is a term given for that.
That is the term we used it.
Right. Okay.
Because the basic difference is when it comes to a major hydro, you have the reservoir and you can control it. But when it comes to mini hydro, which is basically the runoff river type, what we call it, where the river flows, you don't make a storage, but the water that flows, you divert it to a turbine and you generate.
It's weather dependent.
So
right.
You cannot control the power output control in the sense you can start and stop, but I mean, you cannot run the plant the full capacity right through.
Let's also talk a little bit about Ponarin project as well, if you don't mind.
Yes, it's a good idea, but you know, before that one, I would like to emphasize Ponarin is yet to come, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it is coming up. Before that one, we have some other things to be talked about. Kamal, why don't you talk that one? You know, regarding the small solar and other things.
Yeah, I think
these are about the future projects in line.
Yeah, now to talk about future projects, first I think
give me a second, right? Now we have this VRA, you know, variables, we have the rooftop solar.
Right.
Sometimes we forget to talk about, but that is a contributory factor for now energy mix. It is right now about 325 megawatt right now on the roofs of the people. So it's a considerable number. So while that is going on, this big range of Ponarin, you know, other things are coming like in a big megawatt scale. So we have to talk about the rooftop as well, because it's a significant contributor for the renewables.
And do we see a lot of people getting into this solar energy as
yes,
well?
Yes, yes.
In Sri Lanka?
Yes. Initially, it was CEB introduced way back in 2010 as a net metering. What net metering is, you can have the solar cells on your roof and you can generate for your own consumption and excess can be exported. When
right.
you export that one, you know, you can have not a monetary value, but you can have a energy credit What does it mean is, you know, you can have this particular month, you can export it and have the energy credit. For the next month, you can carry it forward and make use of that energy credit until it is usable. You know, for example, next month, if your consumption of energy generation is less than what you have it, then your energy credit can compensate that one. So like that, it goes on the net metering. In year 2016 or 2015, the CEB has, with the other stakeholder organization, introduced three schemes: net metering, net accounting, and net plus. The same setup, rooftop and the energy setup, you know, we have the three schemes. Earlier net metering, we had the energy credits for the export. In energy accounting, what we did was, for the export, we pay money. Mm-hmm. For the 20-year contract period, we pay for the 7 years, first 22 rupees. For the next of the balance period from 8 years after the 20th year, 1550. So that kind of monetary gain people have. At the same time, we have another scheme called the net plus. That is where the same scenario is there, where the power generation from the house rooftop is not allowed to use for the normal consumption. It is directly fed to the grid and the payment is made accordingly.
Right.
So and that is, you know, give me a second. People are highly involved there. Right now, we're in about 23,000 people are involved. So there's a significant number that I have to talk about.
But I think they do have a cost factor, isn't it?
Of course, yes. Of course. Yes. But at the same time, they have the return. Mm-hmm. If you think about the return of cost factor, the payback period nearly comes about 7 to 8 years.
Right, okay. And we were touching on the future projects. So this is also a concept which people don't highlight. So thank you so much for touching on it. Because we are all in the process of going green, isn't it? So solar energy is encouraged, if I'm not mistaken.
If I just say on the future projects, mm-hmm. now roughly if we think about the, now there's a government policy of 70% energy by renewable sources. That is the government policy. So electricity board is geared for that one. We have to work for that. That's a government policy. Now in order to achieve that one, roughly, now at the moment, our total renewable installed capacity is in the range of 2400 megawatts. Now, in order to achieve this target, this capacity need to be reached somewhere around 7500 megawatt by 2030. Now, how are we going to achieve that one? Now, for that one, mainly the main two sources would be wind and solar. So, solar capacity need to reach 3700 megawatts, which is at present in the range of close to 700 megawatts. So, you can just think of the multitude that we need to invest. In the case of wind, it is 250 megawatts at the moment. It needs to reach
variable part of the demand as well as the variable part of the generation. So it is not easy to do manually. It has to be done very computer sophisticated systems. It has to have a smart grid. Smart grid comes in the smart investment. Smart investment is a smart business model. So in this scenario, everything should be smart. Even the technology should be smart. People are smart in that thinking. So those are challenges. We are working on that and we are enhancing our HR, human resources, in that particular aspect. So we believe we will be able to achieve that one.
We've come towards the latter part of the program as well. So I think even the general public has a role to play in terms of being smart when using electricity. Any advice to the general public?
Yes, the best part I would like to say, please pay the electricity bills on time. Because it is very, very important for us at this moment. CEB is a cash trap, you know, at this moment. We need money from the people, but we have saved, you know, but to pay them electricity bills on time.
And also about how they should be acting in terms of saving electricity, going green.
Shall I? Yeah.
Yes.
I did not touch about that one. You know, electricity is the only commodity where the generation, the same entity is called not to use. Where normally what we do is production and making the marketing make use of maximum. Mm-hmm. Here we say we generate, at the same time say not to use much. So in that scenario, what you say is, no, conserve. So conservation is from the people. The conservation is help for the country, for the environmental greenhouse gas emission reductions. It will definitely use for the country and the people for the climate change activities. You know, the Paris, now the Paris gas law 26, COP 26 also coming now. They have made the fantastic plan, so we have to work on that one. That is also talking about the climate change activities. So we are in the same umbrella.
Exactly, and I think everybody has to play their part well, and in terms of working on the renewable energy, I think a plan is set and we are hoping for the best. Thank you so much for being a part of the show. We've come to the end of our program Spotlight. It was really nice talking to you, and thank you for the insight on the projects and also about the work done by the Ceylon Electricity Report. So once again, I would like to thank Mr. Ronald Comister for being
much.
A part of the show, yeah. And thank you very much, Mr. Kamal Pereira, for being a part of the show. We had two Deputy General Managers of the Ceylon Electricity Board with us today on Spotlight. Thank you so much for tuning in. Have a pleasant night.